Good morning, friends and brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to our online Sunday service this morning. It is a great joy to be able to gather here online and worship the Lord together. As we transition from CMCO to RMCO, we are reminded times and times again that our God is a merciful God and He is full of grace. So this morning, let us shout for joy to the Lord. Let us worship the Lord with gladness. Let us enter His gates with thanksgiving in our hearts. Let us enter His courts with praise. For the Lord is good and His love endures forever.
to you.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Exodus chapter 18, verses 1 to 12, and Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1. Now Jethro, the priest of Midian, and the father-in-law of Moses, heard of everything God had done for Moses and for his people Israel, and how the Lord had brought Israel out of Egypt. After Moses had sent away his wife Zipporah, his father-in-law Jethro received her and her two sons. One son was named Gershom, for Moses said, "I have become a foreigner in a foreign land." And the other was named Eleazar, for he said, "My father's God was my helper. He saved me from the sword of Pharaoh." Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, together with Moses' son and wife, came to him in the wilderness, where he was camped near the mountain of God. Jethro had sent word to him, "I, your father-in-law Jethro, am coming to you with your wife and her two sons." So Moses went out to meet his father-in-law and bowed down and kissed him. They greeted each other and then went into the tent. Moses told his father-in-law about everything the Lord had done to Pharaoh and the Egyptians for Israel's sake and about all the hardships they had met along the way, and how the Lord had saved them. Jethro was delighted to hear about all the good things the Lord had done for Israel in rescuing them from the hand of the Egyptians. He said, "Praise be to the Lord, who rescued you from the hand of the Egyptians and of Pharaoh, and who rescued the people from the hand of the Egyptians. Now I know that the Lord is greater than all other gods, for he did this to those who had treated Israel arrogantly. Then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, brought a burnt offering and other sacrifices to God, and Aaron came with all the elders of Israel to eat a meal with Moses' father-in-law in the presence of God. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under God's heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, the giver of your precious word to us, as we come to worship you and now to meditate upon your word, make your word real to each one of us. Speak to our innermost being and enable us to appropriate your word and put it into practice, and to seek your purpose, your timing upon our life and living. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning, church. The title of my message this morning is A Time for Everything. This hymn, in His time, God makes all things beautiful in His time. Now this timeless hymn brings much consolation to many who are being assured of God's presence with them. A friend of mine sang this hymn during his wedding. A mother told me about her daughter who liked this hymn very much. The mother could tell how these hymns had brought much joy and comfort to her daughter through the various seasons of her life until she passed on. Everything works according to His time. In His time, God makes all things beautiful in His time. The sentiment of this hymn was echoed by the writer of Ecclesiastes in chapter 3, verse 1. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the sun. Friends, our time, life's events, and our future are not governed by chance or fate or luck, but by God. And I'm going to share some thoughts about God's timing based on Exodus chapter 18. Let's begin with A Time for God, verses 1 to 4. The preceding chapters tell about Moses' hectic time dealing with the many requests and problems of the Israelites. Now, in this chapter, we read about Moses having rest and recreation for himself, time with his family, and also time with God. Other than catching up with his family, Moses told his family and father-in-law Jethro about God's deliverance, His leading, and His providence since they left Egypt. It is a family testimony time. Likewise, we should have family testimony time or small group testimony time. A couple once told me how they engaged with their child about his day in school. They asked about what he likes and his delights and what he has learned in school. And they also asked him how he's coping with his studies, his sports, and his friends, and they would pray with him. They do it frequently with him. I heard about children asking their parents regarding COVID-19. One parent said she told her children about viruses that cause people to fall sick. Viruses are deadly, like COVID-19, which is why we need to wear face masks, use sanitizer, wash our hands with soap, to practice social distancing. And most important of all, to pray to God for protection, for good health, and to put a stop to COVID-19. So how are you explaining this COVID-19 to your children and to your friends? Well, it should not be a lecture to them, but to put God and His words into their life. Now, our rest time also includes time for God. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, after God had completed His creation, He rested from His work. Not because He was tired physically and emotionally, but to teach us about our need to rest our bodies and minds and to worship Him. Now of late, I have been thinking about what God has said at the completion of His creation. God said, "It was very good." It was very good. To me, it was His remark, His reflection of His work. Dear friends, after a week of work in the office, or at home, or in school, or whatever that we have been doing, do we reflect on it and be able to say, "That is good because it has benefited someone, or your family, or the company, or the church, or the larger community of Ipoh and Malaysia? Or as for my mistake, it has helped me to know my blind spots." Well, we often say, "I am always right about this. Why do you say that I am wrong?" Well, we can't see our blind spot when others can see it. Coming to Sabbath rest, there are Christians who look upon the Sabbath rest or Sunday worship as a law, a burden, an imposition on them. Yes, it is the fourth commandment listed in Exodus chapter 20. A proper understanding, regard for any commandment is to see it as a means whereby we regulate our relationship with God, or having a good relationship with God. A commandment is relational and reciprocal as well. As for Sabbath rest, it is intended for us to have relationship with God. It is our relational bonding with God. Of course, this relational bonding and fellowship also include our loved ones, our family, and the church community. Well, if there is timing, there has got to be a time frame, which is like schools having timetable for their lessons. The Ministry of Education has announced, "Be ready for schools." We move to God's time frame, verses 5 to 7. A time for everything indicates God's time frame. God is not a haphazard God in dealing with lives and events. He is God of human history. He is God of order. The coming together of Moses, his family, and Jethro was an act of God's perfect timing. When we read Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1 to verse 4, it is reassuring to know that God has been unfolding his plans for us from the very start of our lives until now. And this is followed through by the words of Jeremiah in 29 verse 11, talking about plans for our welfare that give us hope and future. During a church outing to one of those small villages in the state of Pahang, I talked to several elderly people residing there. I asked about the prospect of their village. They told me, since there was zero development, many young people had left the village to work elsewhere. The elderly people are the ones left behind to take care of themselves. They looked downcast and said, why? There is no future for them and their village. The village life may end with them. We too can be downcast, sad, lost hope. When we do not have hope in God. Now listen to these words of counsel from the psalmist in Psalm 42 and verse 5. It says to us, have hope in God and praise Him. How to have hope in God? Hope in our Christian understanding is to journey, to step forward with God into the future with faith and trust because He has a plan for us. And He is leading us to His plan. Our unknown future is known to God. Let me repeat. Our unknown future is known to God. Christian hope has the certainty, dependability, sustainability, and it is not wishful thinking or trying our luck. The meeting of Moses with his family, especially with Jethro, would lead Moses to learn about governing, sharing of work, and division of labor from Jethro. In God's time frame, we see the unfolding of his plans in the later part of chapter 18. As a case in point, in the account of the great flood in Genesis chapter 6 to 8, God gave sufficient time for Noah to build the ark according to his specification. Now when the ark was completed, and when his family and the animals were already in the ark, then only the flood came. And it was after the flood had subsided that God told Noah to leave the ark together with his family, livestock, and animals. Well, it involves God's timing and Noah's patience in obeying. It is like complying with the SOP of MCO. At the onset, people like me who are on the go felt as if I was in prison. Now, talking about God's time frame. The account of Isaiah 40 was a roadmap for the restoration and rebuilding of Jerusalem that was destroyed by enemies. Now for the restoration to take place, the people must be willing to shine for the Lord by overcoming their sins. They must be ready to shine as light in darkness. Now, the essence of this restoration is to be patient with God. It is not going to be you pray and repent today. Tomorrow you will see the new Jerusalem. No, it is not like that. One must be consistent and persevering in praying and trusting God to fulfill His promise in His time. The restoration will not be immediate. Nonetheless, the Lord will do it as He had promised. In Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 22, God says, "I am the Lord. In its time, I will do it swiftly." When we pray for a nation, the governing authorities and the people to change for the better, we might not see immediate changes. Changes will take time. And we must trust that God will do it according to His perfect timing. Well, God's timing for Isaac's marriage to Rebecca in Genesis chapter 24. Yes, it was love at first sight, but the love was not blind. Blind love will lead us to nowhere. Isaac's sparks of love for Rebecca was according to God's choice for him and also his timing. Now, Abraham did not compromise on choosing a wife for Isaac. The guidelines were these. She must be a believer. She must be willing to follow Isaac and the children into Canaan. The one leading the search party to find Isaac's life partner prayed this prayer. Genesis 24, verse 12. "O Lord, God of my master Abraham, give me success today and show kindness to my master Abraham." It was not an easy assignment as chief of the search party, as he must follow the guidelines set by Abraham. She is to be a believer, humble, hospitable, self-giving, and non-calculative. If she says, "I give you 1 cent, I want 3 cents back in return," that won't work. But let me also say to you, this is not the criteria for a perfect spouse, but to find a God-revering and faithful spouse. Now the search party was prayerful and discerning in looking for the woman whom God has chosen to be the wife of Isaac. Eventually, they found Rebecca to be the wife of Isaac. Now, this account of finding a life's partner for Isaac is a reminder to those seeking life's partner that they are to be prayerful and discerning before committing to a lifelong relationship. Do not rush into marriage without prayerful consideration. And don't judge a book by its cover. Anything that is not of God is never right from the very start. Anything that is not of God is never right from the very start. You will need the counsel of your parents, older people in your family, godly people in your church, or your SG people to help you make the choice. Now, people who pray and honor God in their marriages will have God to fall back on when things don't go well. Now, Jesus, our Lord, observe God's timing throughout his earthly ministry. In John chapter 7, verse 6, we read about Jesus' brother pestering him to show up in Jerusalem at the Feast of Tabernacle, where he could perform miracles before a large crowd and to make himself known to them as the Messiah, the Savior of the people. Jesus did not follow the plan. Jesus knew when to go to Jerusalem. And he did go to Jerusalem, and he preached there. And people were amazed by his preaching. Now, Jesus was able to discern the timing of his going to Jerusalem because he had a close fellowship with God. Jesus declared, "I and my Father are one. I came to earth to do the will of God." So there is a need for us to lay our plans before God and seek His leading and guidance. Remember the counsel we read in James chapter 4, verse 15. If it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. There was this village congregation in India who had been without a pastor for some years, and they wanted a pastor or a missionary very much. Now, over in America, there was this Bible student who had completed his studies, and he asked his missions organization to send him to India. He could have served comfortably in America. The Lord had placed on him the burden to go to India. What a right choice in God's timing and availability. Well, God makes all things beautiful in His time. Verses 8 to 12. The meeting of Moses, his family, and Jethro was not merely a family gathering. It turned out to be a worship service. Jethro, who had heard about God and his deeds in the past, at that worship, he confessed his faith in God publicly. This was his faith affirmation. "Now I know that the Lord is greater than all other gods," to stand. It came out from the mouth of a man who was a non-Israelite and an outsider. I'm sure this is also your first affirmation when you came to faith in Jesus Christ. Share it with your family. Share it with your friends. Jethro, who lived among unbelievers, was able to distinguish the true and living God whom the Israelites worship, and we too worship. Not only did Jethro confess his faith in the true God, he even offered a burnt offering to God, which was an act of worship, an act of surrendering himself to God. Friends, isn't that marvelous when God makes all things beautiful in His own time? All this happens in God's timing as He makes all things fitting and beautiful. And my closing remark is this. Pray that God will continue to shape and direct our lives and our plans in line with His timing and purposes for us. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, even as we have heard your word to us, enable us to be patient and humble to seek your will and purpose for our life and our living. And I pray, God, that You will continue to speak to us and guide us into the purpose, the plan that you have for us. For you intend to give us hope and a future. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us continue to worship the Lord with our offering. Let us pray the offertory prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gifts and blessings that you have given to us in our lives. Even through difficult times, you have never failed to provide. So this morning, as we honor you with our offering, may our offering bless your church and your ministries. May our offering bless the people in need. Help us to give with a cheerful and joyful heart. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
His grace and His face shine upon.